because justice is secondary. I will skip this part and go to this part, the final part of the talk. Science can be so vital as well for some people to live on. I have learned this lesson from the father of my friend. Remember the student leader who was shot dead and dragged along the soccer field? This is him. Right after the massacre was over, my friend's name appeared on the police wanted list, who remained at large, even though it was shot dead already. Long story why it happened that way. The father spent many days without success to find his son. He went to his son's apartment. He found an unfinished plate of food, half a cup of cold coffee in the messy room. He then went back and forth among several police stations, hospital, and to his friends' places, searching repeatedly for the names of the arrest, for the injured students, all the list. His name doesn't appear on any list except the list of those wanted who remain at large. Days of searching went by in vain. The result was never different at home. He came from a small town, which is considered by the government as a pink. You know the pink? Maybe you don't know. It means in the anti-communist period, it means the communist infected. Not really red area, but communist infected area. The family came from that part of the southern Thailand. Rumors spread locally that, spread by local police and by local insurgents, that the son led a local guerrilla unit attacking the government post. That kind of rumor would have caused a parent, a father, mother concern, right? But for this parent, that rumor gives them hope that their son is alive. They even visited several police and soldier bases in the insurgent areas, distributing the picture of their sons, asking them if the police and soldiers seen their son. They begged police and soldiers not to kill their son. The parents waiting for their son to come home for 20 years. Among their son's friends, including me, we heard from a few witnesses that he was shot dead that morning, we know that. But there was no other hard evidence since the body was never found. And his name was remained on not among the dead, his name was among the person at large. A few years after the massacre, we saw the photos of him being grabbed, this one. We only saw it a few years after, not right away. But the picture was not conclusive, you see. It's not conclusive, it's him or not. But we believe that it's him. In any case, we were his friends. We were all cowards. None of us has the courage to tell his parents, who still believe that their son is still alive. Only in 1996, the silence surrounding the massacre was broken. 20 years of wait were finally over. A few of the son's friends, a group of my friends, went down to his hometown, showed them the photos, and we have more photos, and explained to them his son has died since 1976. However, to them, it's not quite a closure yet, since the son's body was not found. During the first year of the search for this, for his search for the son, the father kept a memoir. It is an account of frustrating and very sad father, but who never abandoned his hope. Then, after recording of one day in early 1977, which means a few months after he began his search, the memoir stopped abruptly. The father stopped writing, simply stopped. No new entry, no reflection, no conclusion, nothing, just stopped. kept the diary for 20 years until 1996. Then he shared with us, friends of his son. I read it. Then I asked him, would you like to write something that would bring the ending to the diary? With additional information he know by then. Think about it. It was the most stupid question and disgusting question I ever asked in my life. He stared at me, but didn't say a word. I can't pretend to know what is in his mind, but I kept wondering, too much a scholar, I kept wondering why there's no ending. It turned out I want an ending more than his father. It's me who want a closure. In 2001, as I began research for this book, which lasts 17 years, one of my top personal quests was to find out about his body, my friend's body. Finally, I found the answer, long story to tell, but I found the answer, including why the police thought he was still at large, even though he was among the dead. His body was at the police hospital all along from that morning. And why his parents never recognized his body. I found the answer. I got all the answers. One afternoon in September 2001, I told the parents everything I know about their son and his body. Telling the truth was so cruel. I realized too, by that moment, why the father's memoir stopped abruptly. The silence after the last page was full of hope. The father's memory and hope continued in that space of silence. Either hopeful memory for his son, who may be alive and will return soon. All the painful memories that were beyond words, whatever. Silence of the father was full of memory, without the closure of his diary. The father chose to live on with the memories in the blank space of silence. That's how I realized I know the answer, and I realized why my question to him to finish the memoir is the most stupid question to ask. I helped shatter their hope. Believe me, truth was not always good. I learned with myself truth was cruel. The mother passed away in December 2002. Shortly before then, she said in an interview or to a magazine that she could not yet come to terms with the truth. The father passed away in early 2016, almost 40 years after the massacre. The unforgetting of the October massacre lives on. Thank you.
整个社会参与的一个 complicit 的一个情感结构的共构。那这里面在泰国的话，包括了对于皇室的感恩和不敢直问，对于这个历史多方面的 public 的和那个军方几次政权轮替之后的改写历史、改写记忆。那更当然包括当时的局势，这就是为什么我们是说从这个东北亚到东南亚，在冷战时期实际上是受到了不只是 local， 我们看到的是泰国的、韩国的、印尼的、越南的、柬埔寨的、马来西亚的、台湾的等等地区的反共亲共的这种政治暴力，它背后其实还包括了中国的革命输出，在香港也掀起了一波。那可是它这革命输出也牵涉到了实际上这几个地区的当时的政权，不管是军政府或者皇室，唯一没有被殖民的这个泰国、台湾、韩国和印尼、马来西亚、新加坡等等，都是美国支持的。比如说美国的这所谓的冷战就变成是说，从 US 到这个中国或者苏联，它牵动的是我们 local 的这个复杂的记忆的这个过程。所以我们现在要去面对的就是背后的这个复杂的运作要如何去思考。那我们现在 open up for question and comment，我们尽量收集问题，中文都可以。好，那我们会有 interpretation， 我们可以还至少有15分钟，对，16分钟。 OK， 好，请。大家问题可以简短，可是我们尽量多收集一点问题。这种对于过去历史暴力、政治暴力的这个 suppression， 中国也有啊。对于六四还不能多谈，对于文革更无法谈了。然后这种那个当时群众被激发的那个 jubilance， 就是欢喜的群众的欢喜的对于暴力的欢喜。这是非常奇特的现象。好，请涂老师。
Okay, thank you for the wonderful moving lecture. I'm very intrigued by the key word you raised at the very beginning, the rest of the rest, because it's in terms of at least three aspects, geopolitical hierarchy and also the perpetrator victim's ambivalence, and also, more importantly, that's my question, massacre judged by the number of body counts, because, you know, 40 something people, you know, it's not so there's some sort of also silencing, or, you know, I think you probably get this kind of question a lot, you know, compared to large scale massacre, you know, it's not on a large scale, but do we judge the weight and gravity of the incident purely by the number? I think that's the first question. The other is the other meaning of the of rest, as in like rest in peace. Okay, so and that has to do with your keyword silence or silencing. So if there's this rest of the rest, do they rest or do they rise? And I think towards the end there's. There's some sort of implied answer, but maybe you can, if you can say more about it, you know, it would be great. Thank you.
啊，谢谢。有没有其他问题 ？Other questions?
Thanks very much, Professor, for your paper, and I especially touched with your personal story. I have two questions, basically following up the question concerning the. Conceptual idea of science. I can sense that because the idea can be applied to different contextual comparison, like cases in China talking about June 4th event, or even cases in Hong Kong talking about social movement. So I would like to see if you have any kind of observation or even research having that kind of contextual comparison. And the second question would be quite like the idea science, silence. Would that be also be linked to some kind of resistance against dominant logic of hierarchy or power relationship? So thank you.
Maybe one, two more questions. Over there.
我先用中文讲一下，就是我昨天听了一场演讲，然后他其实就是有说一句，就是说，其实文明的兴起其实源自于就是大量的屠杀，因为大量的屠杀的话，它才能够就是融合，就是说它才能够就是慢慢的让那个这个政治保持一个这个一个那个稳定的状态，就是。因为我引用了耶稣的那个钉在十字架的一个例子，耶稣钉在十字架的时候，其实代表的就是，其实他不仅其实呈现了那个邪恶，其实他展现的是那个天父上帝的那个慈善，以及那个耶稣的那个无辜。那其实这个例子其实也。展现在那个就是之后，像欧洲殖民统治，或者是像亚美尼亚大屠杀这个例子。那其实这个例子的话，对不起，容我讲一下，就是亚美尼亚大屠杀。
那也多少时间了？那个 short。
就是说，因为我是想请问教授，就是说。文明是不是就是靠着就是大量的屠杀才能够奠基而成 ？Thank you very much.
Final question. Yeah, go ahead.
Thank you very much for this touching talk.